So that brings us to this concept of cache affinity scheduling. Basically, the idea is very, very simple. And that is, if let's say that on a particular processor P1, I had this thread T1 running for a while, and it got descheduled at some point of time because it made an I/O call, it tried to synchronize with another thread, whatever it is, or time quantum expired for T1. Any of those situations will result in T1 getting descheduled. And then the scheduler is going to use the processor for perhaps running some other thread. But finally, at some point of time, if T1 gets ready to be scheduled again, it makes a lot of sense for T1 to be scheduled on the same processor. Why? Because it used to run on this processor P1, and therefore the memory contents of T1 that it needed to have its execution were in the cache of P1. And therefore, when T1 gets ready to run again, if I schedule T1 on the same processor, it is likely that T1 will find its working set in the caches of P1. That's the reason why it makes sense to say, well, let's look at the affinity of a particular thread to a processor, the cache affinity of a particular thread to a processor. So the cache affinity for this thread is likely to be higher for P1 because it ran on P1 before, got descheduled, and is rescheduled on, when it is time to reschedule it, if you reschedule it on the same processor, good chance that T1 will find its working set in the memory hierarchy, the caches of processor P1. But can something go wrong? Well, what can go wrong is the following. When T1 was descheduled, the scheduler may have decided that, okay, P1 is now available for doing business for some other thread, so it scheduled T2 and it scheduled T3. And eventually, when T1 gets ready to run again, it's ready to run again, but in between, it's running on the processor here and running on the processor again here along this timeline. Two other intervening threads ran on P1. So watch out, the cache may be polluted by the contents of threads T2 and T3 so far as T1 is concerned. So when T1 runs again, it's quite possible that it may not find a lot of its memory contents in the cache because these two guys that got in the middle of its running on the processor P1 may have polluted the cache and gotten rid of a lot of the stuff that used to belong to T1. And therefore, even though we made this choice that, well, when T1 is ready to run, let's put it on P1, where it used to run before, and that way we can ensure that T1's working set is probably in the cache of processor P1. But unfortunately, these intervening threads may have polluted the cache. So that's something that you have to watch out for. So the moral of the story is that you want to exploit cache affinity in scheduling threads on processors, but also you have to be worried about any intervening threads that may have run on the same processor and may have polluted the cache as a result. So that's something that you have to watch out for. So now that I've introduced the idea of cache affinity for a processor, with respect to a particular thread, we're now ready to discuss different scheduling policies that an operating system may choose to employ.